Good morning and welcome to the fifth meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2021. We are joined this morning by Alex Cole-Hamilton, MSP, who is not a member of the committee but he is attending due to his interest in the proceedings. I welcome Alex to the meeting and I invite you to declare any interests relevant to the committee's remit.
I'm grateful to be here but I have no interest to declare.
Thank you. The third agenda item this morning is the decision to take item 7 on the consideration of evidence heard in private. Are members of the committee agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. We are agreed to take agenda item 7 in private. I now move on to agenda item number 4. This morning we'll be taking evidence from a range of stakeholders on vaccination certification. I would like to welcome to the meeting Professor Sir Jonathan Montgomery, Ada Lovelace Institute, Rob Gowans, Policy and Public Affairs Manager, Health and Social Care Alliance Scotland, and Judith Robertson, Chair of Scottish Human Rights Commission. Thank you. The Scottish Government announced its intention to introduce a vaccination certification system on the 1st of September. The Scottish Government's intention is for the scheme to be in place by the 1st of October. The purpose of today's meeting is to take evidence from the stakeholders on the proposed scheme. Some of the details of the scheme are still to be worked out, so we intend to listen to your views and feed them back to the Scottish Ministers directly in our regular evidence sessions with them. Any issues you raise today will also inform our scrutiny of any relevant legislation that is brought forward to give effect to the scheme. As such, your input is very valuable to this committee and we're very pleased to hear from you. I wonder if I could start by asking the witnesses, what are the key priorities that you think should be embedded within the proposed scheme to make it work? Can we start, please, with Professor Sir Jonathan Montgomery?
Thank you very much, Chair. I'm a Professor of Healthcare Law at University College London and my day job. And I've been working with the Ada Lovelace Institute on their project since April 2020 around the use and governance of vaccine passports. I think the key points that we would make is there needs to be clarity around how it is thought that the vaccine certification will help society recover from COVID. There are two main ways in which it might do that. It might be a protection measure to try and reduce the spread. And if that was the case, you might expect not just vaccine certification, but also the use of negative test status and previous infection as an indication of whether or not it is likely that an individual will pass on the virus. And we know that even if those things are put together, this doesn't make things entirely safe. We know from the Cornish Festival Board Masters that even with vaccine passports and testing, around 10% of attendees, that's about 5,000 people, caught the virus. So we need to be clear that if this is about protecting, that it's an effective way of protecting the community from spread, and why it is that the particular areas focused on in the proposed scheme are seen to be both more dangerous and more amenable to increased safety. But that's the first way in which it might be useful to use passports. The second way is that they could operate as an incentive to increase vaccination rates. As the committee will know, the vaccination programme in Scotland has been very successful. And if you look at the whole population, vaccination rates are very high. There's an argument that in the 18-29 groups where most of the proposed areas seem to be popular, the vaccination rates are lower, though first doses in that group, 76%, only 62% fully vaccinated. But that group has not yet had as much time to get vaccinated as others. And it might be that a vaccination certificate could incentivise that group to get vaccinated. But it's also possible that it might increase distrust of the vaccination programme. So understanding why people are hesitant to be vaccinated is really important. And it's possible that it could give a false sense of security if it's thought that vaccination reduces the need for people to take other protective measures such as hand washing, social distance and mask wearing. So there are key things that came out of the Ada Lovelace Institute work around whether or not vaccine passports were effective in those two main arguments in their favour. But there are also a number of concerns that we identified in terms of segregation, stigma, social exclusion, particularly of groups who already suffer other forms of exclusion. And I'm sure other witnesses this morning will say a little bit more about that. The final thing I'd say, I think, from the point of view of the Ada Lovelace work, is the importance of being very careful about the proportionality test that we need to apply. We can't really talk about vaccine passports in the abstract very sensibly. We can talk about their use in particular contexts and at particular times. So the Scott scheme has focused on particular areas. It's also proposing a sunset clause, which Ada Lovelace would support, so that you don't allow passports to merge into some long-term infrastructure, and also a regular review process. Perhaps the committee might also need to think about whether or not there are relevant factors around the background community infection, the replication rate. Scotland is seeing a reduction in cases, and that might reduce the need for introducing vaccine certification. That seems an important calculation in terms of the work that the government needs to have a look at. So I think those, Chair, would be my preliminary remarks. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Montgomery. Can I please bring in Mr. Rob Gowan?
Thank you, Convener. I think there's a number of the points that we would seek sort of greater clarity on, particularly around the scope, the purpose, and the length of the scheme. What data protection and privacy measures would be taken, what controls would be put in place to prevent discriminatory impact on specific population groups, and what the grounds for exemption are. So our view is that it's important that the scheme should take an intersectional equalities and human rights-based approach, not to perpetuate or exacerbate existing inequalities or infringe on people's rights. And there's a number of important considerations around inclusive communications. Communication around the scheme should always be inclusive and accessible, and a digital choice approach should be implemented rather than being entirely a digital system. And I think finally, sort of issues around vaccine hesitancy should be recognised, understood, and considered sensitively and compassionately.
Thank you, Mr. Gowan. Can I please bring in Judith Robertson?
I think it's important to say, from a human rights perspective, the Scottish Government has a duty to take reasonable steps to minimise the risk to life posed by the virus and to protect health. So, however, the measures taken to do so must comply with the UK and, in turn, Scotland's human rights obligations. So, there are a number of human rights engaged by the use of COVID-19 data certificates in Scotland, including the rights to family and private life, culture, and freedom of thought, conscience, and religion. Interference with these rights is permitted only in exceptional circumstances. And I think you might hear quite a lot of repetition, to be honest, this morning in different ways from our panellists, as having heard both Professor Montgomery and Rob. I think you're going to hear the same themes coming through. But interference with the rights engaged under with the use of certification is permitted only in exceptional circumstances, where it can be clearly shown that the measure is necessary to achieve a pressing social need, and that it is proportionate, as has already been mentioned, taking into account the degree to which people's human rights would be impacted. And within that, the availability of alternative measures which would have a less severe impact on their rights. So the government obligation is to ensure that those rights are appropriately balanced, and that the impact on individuals by the introduction of these schemes is understood, explored, and reduced and mitigated to the greatest extent. So on that basis, as the implementation of a certification scheme would interfere with people's human rights, before proceeding with such a scheme, the government must demonstrate that, firstly, it is necessary to achieve the legitimate aims of protecting life and promoting health, and secondly, that the interference with people's human rights is proportionate, going no further than is necessary to achieve the aim. These are the two very important tests that the government must engage with when actually proposing to interfere with people's human rights explicitly as a result of government policy. So, as Professor Montgomery has outlined, reference has been made in the process to both, as the aims of the scheme, to both reducing transmission of COVID-19 and encouraging uptake of the vaccine, particularly among young people. The government, therefore, should be specific in setting out each aim and the evidence relied upon in concluding that mandating vaccine certifications in these settings is necessary to achieve these aims. So as we go through the evidence session, I'll explore a bit further what the implications of the tests are and how that can be played out by government, run out by government. So thank you.
Thank you very much. If I may just ask one other question. We're seeing vaccination passports being rolled out throughout the world at the moment. And in my personal view, after the past 18 months, it would be irresponsible not to learn lessons and put measures in place to prevent pressures on our NHS and to prevent further lockdown. So if I could ask Professor Jonathan Montgomery, where aroundabouts in the world are there examples of countries that are implementing this successfully?
So one of the challenges in answering that question is that everybody's version of a vaccine passport is slightly different. So the A. Lovelace Institute has collected together a wide number of examples, and I think in our written submission you'll see links to that. Perhaps the one that has been discussed most, or at least was as we had our expert deliberation, was the Israeli experience, where Israel moved quite early in order to introduce what they called a green pass. They had both antibody tests, so the natural immunity current testing and the vaccine status in place. They had the green pass in place for a period, and as it seemed to be not just the effect of the green pass, but the effect of general response, reducing the transmissions, they withdrew it, and then they are talking about introducing it again. Now, I think the key question there is understanding what contribution the vaccine passport made to the response to COVID. It's quite difficult just to simply translate to the Scots position. It is clear that all across the world, people are looking at the ability to know what vaccination status people have. But the use they give to that information varies quite a lot. So I think it would be important to identify those places with a similar sort of context. Israel moved early to get good vaccine coverage, used the green passport in order to get people back into more normal life, then sought to withdraw it again. But then when they saw that the increase of COVID was coming, that they're toying with it. Now, I think that's similar to the sorts of questions that you're addressing, because you're asking at what point would it be appropriate to deploy these certificates. But I don't think you can look abroad and say they're a success or a failure. You can see them as part of a package of measures aimed to enable normal life to resume.
Thank you. Can I move on to questions from members? Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Can I just follow on from the questions posed by the convener, and particularly the comments you made about evidence? And maybe I could direct this first to Professor Montgomery, and then the others could come in. Just to put this whole debate into context, there are people who are ideologically opposed to vaccination passports in all circumstances. I think most people are not in that category, and listening to the replies we've had this morning, it's clear that there is an issue of balance here. So there are human rights considerations around the introduction of vaccine certification, but these human rights have to be balanced against the public health objectives of such a scheme. And you've all talked to one degree or another about evidence. So my question is, and to you, Professor Montgomery, in the first instance, do you believe that the evidence base is solid and that a compelling case has been made so far, by the Scottish Government to introduce vaccine passports here within the very short timescale that is being proposed for doing that? And does that evidence outweigh the human rights concerns that people have at this particular point?
Thank you. I think there are some different segments of the evidence that we need to think about. There's the evidence that relates to how robust the scientific basis is for certifying status. When ADA started doing its work, we were not very confident about that. If you just focus on vaccination status, we can be pretty confident now that we can record the status of people. But the impact of being vaccinated in the face of the Delta variant is not nearly as strong as perhaps people think about in terms of the vaccine certificate. So it can't really be described as a safe pass, that if you've been vaccinated and certified as such, you're in a different category to everybody else. You are less likely to catch the disease, but if you do catch it, you don't seem to be much less likely in passing it on. So I think the set of evidence issues about the science that make us more cautious than we thought we might be about whether or not certification will put identify people who are not presenting others at risk. I think the second bit of evidence is around the areas that the government has chosen to focus on in terms of vaccination certificate. And I haven't seen, but I haven't had very long to look for the detail about why it is that those categories are thought to present higher risk of transmission than others. And I think you'd want to see evidence that there's a significant difference in relation to the transmission rates in those areas than other areas, if you're going to introduce vaccine certification in those particular contexts. And I think you'd also want to understand the alternatives. So if those are venues and events that would be banned or closed for public safety reasons without certification, and certification made it possible to open them, that's a very different situation than if they are thought to just be made a little bit more safe than they would be otherwise. And it would be arguable it's disproportionate to introduce certification if there isn't also a case for closing those events unless only certificated people went there. But I haven't seen that evidence, but I haven't had a lot of chance, and you may have other people on this evidence session who are more clearly placed to that. I think the final bit is that we don't really have very good evidence about how people respond to certification requirements. So the logic of the incentivization argument is that they will respond to that by saying, well, this tips the balance in favour of getting vaccinated. But they may respond to it by choosing to avoid those areas, in which case we're no better off in terms of reopening them. They may respond by increasing distrust of the vaccine programme and government advice because they feel that they've been coerced. And they may also find that we increase the social inclusion without any net benefits. And we don't have particularly good evidence on the actual effect of that, but we have good reason to think that it's a concern. But I think other people giving evidence are probably better placed to address those questions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Montgomery. Just before I bring in Judith Robertson and ask her to comment on that, just to try and draw together what you've said, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, but if I were to sum up what you're saying, is that the case has not yet been made, in your view, for the introduction of vaccine certification in Scotland. You're on mute.
I would say that the case has not been articulated in the way that I'd look for. I would be nervous to say that it couldn't be articulated, but I haven't seen that set out as yet. And obviously there's a short period in which there's been an opportunity to set that out, and it could be pulled together, but I haven't yet seen it.
Thank you. Could I ask Judith Robertson the same question?
From our perspective, that case has not been made at the moment, or if it has, it's not in the public domain, and that is one of the key aspects in relation to those human rights considerations, that the evidence upon which decisions are being made be placed into the public domain, so that not only the government's the basis on which decisions are being made is clear, but that can be interrogated by a wider element of the population. So at the moment, those questions that Professor Montgomery has extremely ably laid out, I think, have not been articulated by the government. There isn't a clarity around what evidence is being used to base the decisions at the moment. I suppose the final thing I would say, in addition to what Professor Montgomery said, is what we haven't seen is any evidence that there has been any engagement with the people most likely to be impacted on by this decision. So those people that in the age group that are being impacted, those people that are most likely to not have taken up the offer of a vaccine for whatever reason, whether that be through conscience, whether that be through inaccessibility or general lack of faith in the system, we know that often those people are the ones that are most vulnerable to the vaccine itself, to the COVID itself, the impact of COVID itself. And so that for us, from taking a broad human rights-based approach to making decisions in this sphere, that engagement with the people most affected by the impact, potential impacts of this decision, is absolutely crucial to better understand the impact, and to therefore either mitigate it or to decide that on balance this is not a decision that we want to move forward on. Our experience and the experience of many others that go before and alongside us is that some of the lack of evidence that might be seen to be underpinning a decision on whether or not certification increases people's resistance to taking the vaccine could be mitigated by that engagement with those most affected. So if there was a very clear discussion had happened, and there was a feedback from those most affected or most impacted saying, no, from our perspective, this is a positive move, that it will incite us. That in and itself is good evidence that the government can use to support its decision. As far as we're aware, that hasn't happened. That doesn't mean to say it hasn't happened. It's just that at the moment we're not aware of it. So there's, and all of this comes under that kind of description of necessity. Is this a necessary intervention and a necessary interference with people's rights to justify on a public health basis? So I think we're really looking to see that evidence published so that interrogation and that understanding can be better made in the public sphere.
Okay, thank you very much, Judith Robertson. I could maybe ask the same question to Rob Gowans, but also just to throw something else in to you, Mr. Gowans. I read in the written submission you put in from the Health and Social Care Alliance that you are asking for a thorough and robust equality impact assessment and human rights impact assessment on the impact of introducing vaccine passports. And you're also asking that any scheme is co-produced with disabled people, people with living with long-term conditions and unpaid carers. To your knowledge, have either of these things been done prior to the introduction of this scheme?
We haven't sort of seen those produced yet, and that's certainly something that we would want to see from the Scottish Government as part of introducing the scheme, is that these things are carried out and published. Certainly we're not aware of the sort of scheme being co-produced or particular sort of consultation with disabled people, people with long-term conditions and unpaid carers, and other groups such as people who are digitally excluded or in sort of different age groups. And that is really important in terms of building the evidence base and allowing us to understand sort of what impact the scheme would have on people's rights and the aims of the scheme sort of outweigh those, and also the sort of the importance of sort of co-production and consultation is that sort of some of the issues can be ironed out by working with the people who are most likely to be affected by them. Certainly at this stage, that's something that we would want to sort of see done and published, and that may be something that the committee wishes to pick up with the Scottish Government.
Okay, thank you. Camilla, I wonder if I could ask just one follow-up question. We were discussing a few moments ago the situation in other countries. I'm aware that, for example, in France, people are given the opportunity to provide a negative test as an alternative to vaccine certification. If the Scottish Government were to go down that route, would that alleviate the concerns that you have around the human rights issues we're discussing this morning? I don't know if Judith Robertson, you want to start on this one.
Certainly, providing choice or broadening the scope and the way the scheme is undertaken has the impact of potentially mitigating that. But I think also that has to be checked and understood as the impact on that on people. People who, for whom testing is an additional burden. So there are a range of issues at play there. Yes, in short, we think that provision could be helpful. But what I suppose we don't know is why that additional measure hasn't been brought in. Again, the evidence isn't there to say one way or another whether or not that has been considered, and if it has been considered, why it hasn't been included, and on what basis it hasn't been included. So there, the short answer is yes, that provides an alternative, which I think is positive, but we don't know why that hasn't been included at the moment.
Okay, thank you. Professor Montgomery?
Thank you very much. Yes, so I think it certainly mitigates some of the risks. I think our evidence from public deliberation, as well as looking at other countries, is that it's very, very important to understand the infrastructure around the provision of certification. So if it's easy to get tested and easy to get vaccinated, then you have choices, and those choices are easy to implement. If those things are hard, then it doesn't make so much difference. People need to be persuaded that what is on offer to them is a realistic choice and not one that is very close to coercion. And that depends not just on accessibility to testing and what gets onto your certificate. It also depends which areas of your life the certification is related to. So these things are all part of a sort of matrix of questions that basically add up to whether or not is proportionate to force people to make choices that they may wish they didn't have to make. But it would certainly be an improvement if there were alternatives to just vaccination status in terms of that proportionality balance.
Okay, thank you. And Rob Gowans.
Yes, I think there's it would be a sort of a positive, or I think certainly that there's kind of alternative measures set out. I think at the moment one of the issues we have with the current scheme is that there isn't a great deal of information available about the evidence and particularly around exemptions and who would be included and not included, and there's potentially that sort of alternative measures may be helpful with that.
Thank you, Camilla.
Thank you. Can I bring in John Mason?
Thanks very much, convener. I mean, we have the situation just now where our hospitals are struggling and the ambulance service is swamped. So we have to take some action. So, I mean, listening to your answers so far, it would just be clean. Would it be cleaner and neater from a kind of human rights point of view and an equalities point of view just to close all the nightclubs, stop all the football matches over 10,000, stop all the concerts? I mean, that would save any human rights issues, wouldn't it? That would just be cleaner. Would that be your preference? I don't mind to ask. Mr. Gowans, perhaps?
I mean, I think it's the point around sort of evidence and clarity around the scheme of sort of whether the kind of the risks of doing so and the risks, the sort of public health would outweigh the human rights considerations, and how that would compare to the relative safety of opening venues with and without the certification. So I think it sort of comes down to the evidence and the clarity around the scheme.
Ms. Robertson, should we just close everything?
I think that's a test really for the government to assess. That's not what we're seeing. We're seeing that in order to assess whether or not the impact of this interference in people's rights is proportionate, is reasonable, is evidence-based, and therefore can be justified on the basis of balancing that up against the economic harms that not both the economic harms and the social harms that come into play.
I think we've frozen there.
We've lost Ms. Robertson at the moment, maybe Mr. Montgomery.
In the necessity of the proportionate nature of it, and is that a valid contribution to make? That's the basis on which the human rights analysis really has to be understood. So if the harms, the wider social harms, pan out as being of far greater significance than the impact on a relatively small number of individuals, then that potentially is a justifiable decision. Or can the impact on those individuals be mitigated by various actions that we're discussing this morning, for example, by producing a negative test? Or there's clearly some thought has gone to, for example, mitigating the digital nature of what's being proposed by producing paper evidence of people's vaccine status. So some measures have been thought of which reduce the impact on people's rights. But from our perspective, it's not clear whether or not how these things have been weighed up, and that really is what we're seeing from a human rights perspective needs to be put into the public domain. It's not a yes or no point. It's have we got the information to actually make that decision, and has the government got that information to make that decision across the board?
I mean, can I just ask you then, Ms. Robertson, on that point? I mean, we've had restrictions for the last year and a half, most of which have been brought in at 2 or 3 days' notice. This one is the slowest we've ever done. It's had the most consultation, the most discussion of any of the restrictions that we've had up till now. So would you have the same criticism of all these other restrictions that we've had, like closing the schools, for example? Have all of these failed from a human rights perspective?
I wouldn't say they failed from a human rights perspective. That's an extreme end of the argument. What I would say is that they haven't fully taken into account all of the human rights implications, and we also totally respect that a lot of decisions were made quickly, and also that when the human rights implications of some of those decisions played out in the public sphere, they were reviewed and new decisions were made. But in this instance, we have had time. So the Commission prepared a briefing on this in April. So there has, and this has been discussed over a long period of months. And so it's not, we indeed have been having conversation with government around some of these measures that we are describing to enhance the process or to make the process more rights compliant. So yeah, there has been time. At this point in the process, we are concerned. We've actually written to the minister to say we're concerned that decision was made quickly in this way because there has been time to actually do those deliberations.
I mean, Professor Montgomery perhaps could come in, and particularly, I mean, I was looking at the Ada Lovelace paper, I think from May, and you had quite an emphasis on, you know, like things like testing behavioural impacts, which is all very well if we've got time, but I mean, surely we don't have time to do all that kind of stuff when we have to act quickly.
So it's obviously very important that we can reopen all areas of our social and economic life. I think the question I haven't seen the answer to is how different is the reopening of these events without vaccine passports from the reopening of them with vaccine passports? Because that's only when you can think that through that, first of all, you can work out whether you need the vaccine passports, whether we've got to a stage in the pandemic where it's become safe to reopen. And secondly, you can't undertake the regular review process, which is a very good idea that is built into the proposals, if you don't understand what your metrics are for working out what is the need for vaccine passports with these events. You won't be able to tell whether or not it's time to lift the restrictions. So it seems to me that you'd need to think through the background community infection rates. So you should not be opening certain events when infection rates are high in the community and rising if they're going to fuel that rise. If, on the other hand, you're in the situation where infection rates in the background community are reducing, you just want to make sure that opening events are not going to slow that. So that's the question about opening, reopening. The sorts of things we've been concerned about in relation to the human rights dimensions is that reopening of society is differential, that enables some groups to get access to those things earlier than others. Now, if that's a measured and planned process, what we're saying to those people who can't get immediate access is it'll come, but you can't have it just yet, because it's either not safe for you or not safe for the community. But I think if you can articulate the plan and work out what will tell you whether the plan is working or not working, then you have a very good framework within which to assess the impact of the vaccine passports. But until those things are articulated, it's hard to know what is success and failure. I hope that at least goes partly to answering your question.
Yeah, I suppose my point on that would be that we have already opened all of these things. It's not a question of we might open them with the passport, but we actually have opened them, and the hospitals are struggling and the ambulances are struggling. So, I mean, it's maybe not a fair question to ask you, but I mean, do you think there's some other action we should take instead of the vaccine passports?
So I could perhaps make an observation. I can't talk about the situation in Scotland. I chair the Oxford University Hospitals Foundation Trust in England. Our hospital is under a lot of pressure, but it's not actually under a lot of pressure primarily because of COVID infection. It's currently under a lot of pressure because of the pent-up demand we are now dealing with, has been suppressed by COVID, and because we have particular challenges in getting people out of hospital into social care, partly because of elements in social care workforce, and thirdly, because of the difficulties in access to primary care with COVID restrictions in place. Now, if your pattern is similar, I think the vaccine passport is going to make a very small contribution to solving that problem. So I think if you think it's safe enough to keep these venues open, then you need to ask how much safer it makes it if we introduce passports, and whether that extra degree of safety justifies the fact that the burden of that safety is falling on a smaller group of the Scottish population, i.e. those people who don't have access to being certificated. So I think it would be wrong to see this as a sort of golden bullet. And that's one of the things that we were concerned about with the Ada Lovelace work, is that people thought that somehow the vaccine passports were the thing that would solve the problem, and they're likely to play only a small part in that.
Okay, thanks very much. And if I may, just one other area I wanted to touch on. I think both in the Human Rights Commission and in the Ada Lovelace submissions, there was questions around, you know, like permitting the use of certificates. So, I mean, we're only insisting, well, look, the plan is to insist on them for nightclubs and football and concerts. But, I mean, some employers, for example, I think care homes are looking at insisting on the employees having vaccines, having a certificate. Is that something that you think the government can do anything about, or is that just entirely up to employers or venue operators or anyone? If a shop wants to insist on a certificate, is that just up to them, or can we do something about that? Maybe Ms. Robertson?
I suppose that's another potential danger of of putting in place an infrastructure which supports certification is that the use of that infrastructure can be abused, and that actually, in having made that decision, then the government has an obligation to ensure that there's a framework for other actors, private actors, non-state actors, to use that infrastructure in a way that potentially has far more impact on people's rights. So I think that does need to be looked at. It needs to be well understood. The implications of bringing in this infrastructure are potentially far-reaching. At the moment, the government's process is relatively limited, and that's a positive thing. However, the government has also talked about expanding the use of the scheme. So the issue applies not just in relation to non-state actors, but also in relation to the government, is that when we bring this in without a legislative sort of basis on which to do that, that in and of itself has the potential to create problems that we have to then deal with after the fact.
Okay, thanks very much. I don't know if either of the other two want to come in on that point. If not, thanks, convener.
Thank you. Can I ask Alex Rowley?
Thank you. Good morning. Can I perhaps ask this question in a different way? Does the government have a responsibility to do its best to protect the majority of people who have taken up the vaccine? I don't know, Professor.
Thank you very much. Well, I think the government has an obligation to protect every citizen and every resident in Scotland. I think it goes back to what we were saying early on about the importance of understanding how it is that it's thought that vaccine passports contribute to that process. So if the issue is around incentivizing people to get the vaccine, then the argument has to be that the whole community is better off with high vaccine coverage, and that it's not just a matter for individuals about whether they choose to be vaccinated or not in their own interests, but also as a member of a community. Now, I worry that the vaccine passports actually undermine the type of arguments that are likely to persuade people to get vaccinated, which are usually around questions about safety, questions about whether or not their particular faith communities support or don't support the use of vaccines, and issues around solidarity and what people like them, the people they perceive as peers, are doing. Now, each of those can be addressed, but rolling them up into the government is saying that you must have this in order to access an event may actually backfire, because actually it just pushes those questions away for a short period. Now, experience, for example, in Oxfordshire, where I work in the NHS, is that working with faith communities through their own leaders, giving them access to the materials they need to advise their members, was actually pretty effective in getting the rates of vaccination up. And your vaccination rates in Scotland are really very high across the board at the older age groups. So I worry that it would undermine the case for improving that solidarity and therefore undermine the protection for the whole community. I think it's understanding why it is that vaccine certification contributes to that. Vaccine certification may reduce the risk of you getting infected in a particular case, but if you're vaccinated, you protect yourself against serious illness. This is primarily about protecting spread through the community, and therefore the people you're protecting there are the vulnerable who either chosen not to be vaccinated or are not able or eligible for vaccination, or particularly vulnerable even if vaccinated because of background conditions. So I'm not sure that I see that this is a step that protects those who are vaccinated, but it is obviously to be assessed in terms of does it protect every individual in the community. Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Gowan.
Yeah, I think the the government's see well, it's an obligation to protect people and to sort of comply with sort of equalities and human rights standards. So I think it's the question of sort of balancing it up against those. And I think it sort of comes back to sort of what does the sort of the evidence tell us about the kind of the relative risks of people at sort of live events and at nightclubs, and sort of balancing up against sort of, some of the issues that have been highlighted around sort of potential issues around sort of really vulnerable groups. I think particularly around vaccine hesitancy. I think it's obviously important that some of those are sort of recognised and understood and sort of considered with sensitivity and compassion. If there's people are sort of not vaccinated as a result of a sort of protective characteristic, that is, if they're sort of medically unable to, or for a range of other reasons, our sort of members of Voluntary Health Scotland produced sort of an excellent report, which the various issues affecting different protected sort of characteristics and why they may be sort of more likely to experience sort of vaccine hesitancy more than other groups. And we know from sort of previous that the people experiencing severe mental illness are less likely to be to get vaccinated, for instance. So I think there's kind of a range of issues to be considered, but I think it's down to sort of some of the kind of the clarity and evidence around the scheme.
Okay. And Judith?
Yeah, to be honest, I think I don't have very much to add to what's been said earlier. I think the obligation on government is to protect all citizens, but to do that in a way that is respects the rights of all citizens, particularly those who are most vulnerable. So most vulnerable to the impact of any measure they take, most vulnerable to the impact of any measure they are seeking to mitigate. For example, in this instance, catching COVID-19. So, and we know that vaccine hesitancy or vaccine take-up rates in areas are the lowest amongst those who are most vulnerable. So that whole understanding of policy around that area, from my perspective, really strongly needs to be built on engagement with those communities, really reaching out into those communities, as Rob has said, to understand what hesitancy is based on, to work with community leaders around how that can be mitigated and alleviated, and really put resources into that. And I'm not saying, that isn't me saying, therefore, we shouldn't use this scheme, but that those measures, and they may well be in place, they may well be have considered, they may have been resourced. I've heard Jonathan Leach many times talking about engagement with faith leaders, etc., to engage people who have got that vaccine hesitancy. But the point from a human rights perspective is have we got the evidence base to ensure that this measure, which absolutely impacts on people's rights, which in and of itself is allowed, but it has to meet certain criteria. It has to have that evidence base in place. It has to meet that test of necessity and proportionality, and also to ensure that it is non-discriminatory. That's really what we're looking for the evidence of here, and that those measures can be justified, the evidence base is solid, and that the balance of harms that the government has consistently talked about very responsibly throughout the whole process is really laid out. I suppose the other question I would ask, my role here is to answer them, is why this feels like a move away from the process that has happened up to now, which is very much being about encouraging people in relation to vaccines, really putting in place that encouraging mechanism, and recognising that in and of itself is a very effective means of supporting people to take it up and enabling that choice. This a certification scheme has much more of the feel of coercion, and really walks into that territory. And it's not clear to me why the government has taken a shift away from its very, you know, publicly declared stance on encouragement into something which is has got a very different feel to it. That would be part for me of that proportionality and necessity test, and laying that out and understanding that is really important.
I think, I mean, just to pick you up on that, because I think that, you know, the government have not brought forward clear evidence to I think suggest that they would be able to achieve their objective here. The main objective seems to be take up of the vaccine, and I did see a report that the Human Rights Commission did a few weeks ago sent to us, which highlighted that the areas people with lower socioeconomic backgrounds and other specific groups, and I'm not sure there's the evidence there to show that. That said, what has been proposed is fairly limited compared to what I see in other countries around the world. I suppose one question there is, is there a danger that we simply accept this and start to roll it out further? But on the question of human rights, what I've found is that, you know, Murdo talked about people being ideologically opposed to this. What I've found is that there is, particularly through social media, a sort of growing misinformation being put out there for anti-vaxxers, and would you agree that the government need to tackle that? But secondly, I saw there was a poll, I think, in the Courier newspaper this week that showed that two-thirds of people believe that those working in the care sector should be sacked if they do not have the vaccine. And what I've found anecdotally, if you're speaking to people and asking people about the vaccine passport, is they raise the question when it comes to human rights, what about my human rights? I've been vaccinated. Do I not have a right to be able to go to big venues and feel that there is some kind of protection in place? Or do those who ideologically oppose vaccination believe it's all a conspiracy theory? Does their rights outstrip the rights of the majority who have been vaccinated? And that is the question that I find that people raise. I don't know what you think about that, Judith.
I think that whole analysis around the balance of rights is actually what's in play here. It's whether people's economic rights, their right to cultural life, the right to private and family life, the right to privacy in relation to health data, the right to not be discriminated against in terms of engaging with cultural events within the community. These are all aspects of people's rights. And so the unpacking of that and the exploring of that and the articulation of that is really what we are talking about here. It's that test of have we looked at all of that and taken all of that into account in this process. And so that really for me I'm not seeking to give you a definitive answer to one way or the other, but simply to help explore or partly to increase understanding of the obligations on government, actually, when taking a rights-based approach, a human rights-based approach, that actually these are the areas that they have to consider and make public their consideration and make that consideration, put that into the public domain and then potentially stand by it so that there are answers to some of these questions in relation to people's different views on the matter.
And could I ask Professor Montgomery, in terms of, I mean, this Parliament has voted for this scheme to go ahead, and whilst I say it's limited, it's going to have a major impact on businesses involved and the costs. But it seems like it is going to go ahead. So, for the committee's perspective, what should we be looking at in terms of that? It's to be reviewed, I think, every 3 weeks. What should we be looking for, and what evidence? There has been a lack of evidence, I accept that, and making the case for this, but what evidence should we be looking for as a committee in terms of reviewing this and continuing to have a view on whether this should continue, whether it should roll out further, or whether it should cease?
I think that's absolutely the right question to be asking at this stage. So I think you need to ask for evidence of whether the introduction of passporting has any identifiable impact on the transmission of the virus in these areas. You should be asking about displacement. So you have some defined areas where it will apply. Does that move people out of those areas into events that are alternative, and how does that change the spread of the virus? The experience of exclusion. So our concerns are all based on the expectation that vulnerable groups, society, will find themselves excluded from social and cultural activities and economic activities they want to do. Is there any evidence that that's actually happening? And I think those will be things that will tell you whether or not the vaccine passport has any discernible difference on the reopening of the economy and what those differences might be. If you discover that there doesn't appear to be any impact on the reduction of transmission, then that would suggest that the impact on people being excluded, you know, are not justifiable. If, on the other hand, you discover that the impact on transmission is noticeable and that those excluded have alternatives where they can express themselves, you're saying that, you know, that's a proportionate response for the period when it's needed as part of a gradual reopening of everything to everybody. I think those are the sorts of questions I would be asking for data on if I were in your position.
Thank you. Thank you, Camilla.
Can I ask Brian Whittle?
Thank you, Kavira. Good morning to the panel. I think I start just reiterating this, the concern that there is a lack of meaningful consultation prior to the decision to implement, and what you have said this morning around the case has yet to be demonstrated in the public domain. My concern, of course, is that the evidence actually doesn't exist. But looking through some of the papers we have today, I note that one of the biggest disparities in vaccination uptake actually is related to ethnicity, and that those in the BAME community have a significantly less vaccine uptake than some of the majority of our population. Do you think this has been taken into consideration? Do you think the vaccine passport will tackle the ethnicity vaccine concern? And my view here is that what we're likely to do in terms of the government's plan to increase vaccine uptake, it will incentivise those only who frequent the likes of nightclubs and football stadiums, and actually it will continue to drive this inequality in our society. I wonder if maybe ask Professor Montgomery to start with that question.
Thank you very much. So, I mean, I think the public engagement work that Ada Lovelace carried out identified trust as a key element of both the use of things like COVID passports and to government initiatives generally. My worry about vaccine passporting is that it doesn't really address the reasons why people are hesitant. So there will be some people who have specific reasons around the vaccines for not wanting getting vaccinated. They may believe they're not unconvinced about safety. They may be taken in by some of the anti-vax rhetoric. There are some who come from communities who are worried about the origins of the vaccine and the research. Others who have concerns about particular elements that faith leaders can address. But I think that there is an understandable distrust amongst those communities who feel that they are neglected by society, who experience more heavy-handed policing, greater surveillance amongst their communities. And if you move to a passporting system, in a sense, you may be reinforcing their sense of not being taken, not being respected, and having their needs taken seriously. So we've certainly seen in the area of the NHS in England that I'm dealing with, delay people from BAME communities picking up the vaccine, because while we felt that they should be encouraged to have it early because they were more vulnerable, they wanted more reassurance that the vaccine was safe. And we had this amongst our own staff in the hospital. They didn't want to be in the first wave of vaccination, but they've been happy to be vaccinated later on because they're just a bit more cautious about what is being said to them. So I think what you worry about with vaccine passports is that instead of seeking to address the reasons for distrust and concern, you aim to up the stakes for people and say, if you want to enter these things, you have to be vaccinated. And that may exacerbate distrust and come back to haunt us. I also think the point you're making about the areas that are suggested for passporting may not be the areas that actually are likely to be taken up by the people we're most worried about. That may be because they're the sorts of events that their communities don't use. It may be because they don't have the finances to attend those sorts of events. And it would be a displacement, I think, of attention if this was thought to be the solution to vaccine hesitancy. And I would think that you would want to see alongside this initiative other ways of focusing the attention on how to enable people to take up the opportunity to protect themselves through vaccines. Thank you.
I think I wonder if Judith Robertson has a comment to make on that.
I think for me that comprehensive programme of evidence-based programme and of really understanding vaccine hesitancy, how that's impacting on different groups where take-up rates are low, whether it's vaccine hesitancy, what is the issue at stake? There could be language barriers, there could be all sorts of barriers to people engaging with the vaccines. But again, not seeing that in the round, if the reason is uptake, and we know that is one of the reasons that the certification scheme has been brought forward, we would need to see a comprehensive analysis of those groups for whom uptake is low, the reasons in relation to that, and what additional measures are being put in place to ensure that those groups are being reached. Neither am I saying that some of these measures aren't being undertaken, but that full sort of laying out of the measures would really assist in seeing whether or not this scheme, the certification scheme, is either having impact in those areas, having impact in other areas, and seeing whether or not it's increasing uptake, as Professor Montgomery is outlining. I also wanted to raise, just to come back on the point about review. Initially, we understood that the process would be subject to review by the Scottish Parliament every 3 weeks. But we note that this has since been changed to refer to ministerial review every 3 weeks. And so we would seek to clarify that, but also to ensure that review is done transparently and publicly, and is testing the necessity and proportionality of the measures, as has been discussed just now. So we would very much welcome that being put back to a review by the Scottish Parliament, if it has indeed moved to a ministerial review.
And I don't know, I'll give Rob Gowan the opportunity to answer that or add to that if he wants.
I think the other witnesses have covered a lot of the points that I would have made, but I think to reiterate it, it needs to be sort of part of a kind of a basket of measures. So for instance, in particular, Roops is sort of providing clear information in different languages, different formats, sort of providing reassurance around things like sort of side effects and potential sort of vaccine, sort of assertive outreach to with people, sort of community leaders, people who people trust. I suppose sort of part of the things come back to is that sort of one of the areas we would like sort of greater clarity around is around, I suppose, the kind of the aims and the scope of the scheme. So there's discussion about the sort of relative the ambitions of the scheme to encourage more people to get vaccinated and to as a sort of public health measure, but I suppose it in terms of the measures sort of proportionate to what the kind of the aims are and where the evidence is for kind of how effective it's thought to be for sort of targeting particular groups and why particular has been chosen. So I think there's sort of a sort of number of areas around there of greater clarity is needed.
Thank you. I think probably in a reasonably similar vein, as I said, of the introduction of vaccine passports, the Scottish Government have told us, is in essence to try and drive behaviour towards being vaccinated. But in driving that in behavioural drivers, the hospitality sector have indicated that there's an inequality here because venues who offer similar services but have a different designation, their concern is that that will drive public behaviour away from those places that require a vaccine passport and towards those places who don't. I'll start with Mr. Gibbons, since you were the last to answer the last time.
I think there's interventions there, and it's potentially one of the things that sort of as we've seen, and I noticed the committee heard in sort of quite a lot of detail from the kind of Licensed Trade Association last week about sort of some of the measures. I suppose it's so certainly for us it's around sort of the evidence, and it's an area again, I suppose, where sort of co-production of the scheme with different groups would have been helpful in terms of understanding how it's likely to affect people's behaviour, whether it's that they would more likely to get the vaccine so that they can access nightclubs and venues, or whether it's that they'll sort of go elsewhere or sort of wouldn't. So I think again a sort of point around a sort of kind of clarity and evidence which we would welcome.
Can I ask Judith Robertson to make a comment?
Again, I agree with what Rob was saying around the evidence base. I think it harks back to the comment Professor Montgomery made around displacement and seeing whether or not the existence of the scheme displaces activity away from the places where the scheme applies to those places where it doesn't apply, and does that in and of itself increase harm or does it actually or does it possibly make very little difference because it's not certification that is actually going to make the difference. It's whether other behaviours are enabled and allowed in those spaces. So I get, from my perspective, that level of detail is something that would have to be assessed, considered, put into the frame in terms of the analysis and the measures and the tests that the government is doing to decide which venues it's going to apply the scheme to and which it isn't. But it's really having that test, making that test explicit, and then being able to measure against it, which is going to give you a decent evidence base on which to make decisions going forward.
Anything to add, Professor Montgomery?
I think I would say, first of all, that I mean that might be a public health benefit to displace people from the specified areas and events into others. if the evidence shows that those nightclubs, sunset indoor events, etc., are more risky places, then you would like people to live their lives in places that are less risky. So that could be a benefit if the evidence is clear. My only other comment, I think, would be that if we're trying to incentivize take up of vaccinations, we need to ask ourselves how we reduce the barriers to that to being as low as possible. So if you have opportunities, because these are areas that people want to go and they're in a group where vaccination rates are lower, the obvious question to be asking ourselves at that point is, can you, alongside the introduction of the certification requirement, make it really easy to get vaccinated? You know, so pop up vaccination clinics at places that young people go to may be the key thing to overcoming hesitancy, because it may be as much to do with it being difficult to access vaccines for them if you can't travel. So if you put this alongside, if you want to go here, you want to get your tickets, you can't come until you're vaccinated, but why don't you get the vaccination now? You may have an impact on it. But this is all about understanding how it is thought that certification will have an impact on people's thinking around vaccine hesitancy. And that's where I think it would just be really helpful to understand more clearly the rationale for introducing passports at this point for these sorts of venues and how it will overcome hesitancy. Thank you.
I think just one brief one for me. I know in the Ada Lovelace submission that it suggests that the Scottish Government have a responsibility to protect against errors, harms and discrimination. I think we all recognise that introduction of new technology does need a lead time going live to protect against those issues and protect against data breaches. There is a distinct lack of time and preparation here. Is that an issue that should concern us? I will ask Professor Montgomery, since it was his submission.
So it's definitely a question that I think should be in your mind. You should, though, separate out those elements of data security risk which are particular to vaccine passports and those which have already been addressed in relation to other questions. So this is not something that is coming out of nowhere with no similar app-based approaches. You have contact tracing apps, you have ways of accessing health records. So I don't think this is a standing start. What you should ask, I think, is whether or not the way in which the vaccination certificate takes place is privacy protecting, in that it doesn't actually say give too much information about individuals other than what is necessary for the proof of vaccination. But the QR code approach is designed to reveal as little as possible about people. And you should be concerned to be reassured that the appropriate security in terms of deleting data after its purpose is finished, all those sort of things, which are standard data protection approaches, are in place. But I think it would be wrong to say that this is suddenly creating a set of issues which are not already known about, but checking that the same security protocols are in place and protections would obviously be an element of oversight of the scheme. Thank you.
Thank you, Camilla.
Thank you. Can we move to Jim Fairley, then we'll finish with Alex.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I should just say that, I have to say, when the idea of a vaccine passport was introduced, it did slightly concern me. But I go back to the very beginning. We all accept that coronavirus kills people. We accept that we can't really know for any certainty how the virus is going to change, what other variants are going to come forward. But we also accept that the vaccine has had a huge impact in controlling our ability or helping us get our ability back to have the freedoms that we currently have. So that was my starting point, and I'm pretty sure that everybody in the committee here today would agree that that's where we should be looking at, given the fact that there's a world pandemic. But there was something that was touched on earlier on that Alec here mentioned about care homes. Now, I know that there are care, so I'm going to go to the extreme end of how we deal with this. We either shut down society or we go to the next extreme end. And that's, there are care homes. There's a care home company based in England. I can't remember the name of it. They're based in England. I think they have a care home in my constituency, and they're currently sacking people who haven't agreed to get vaccinated. And they're sacking them on the basis that they can't be guaranteed to protect the people who they're employed to protect. So they're balancing the right, the human right of the person who doesn't want to be vaccinated against the right of the person who requires to be protected. How do you as a panel feel about that position? Start with yourself, Mr. Montgomery.
Thank you. My microphone's gone live now. So this is obviously a slightly different issue from the passporting issue. It's a very live issue south of the border, where we are looking at mandatory vaccination for care home staff and also consulting around staff working on the front line in the NHS. I think earlier on in the pandemic, we were hopeful that your vaccination status would not only reflect your vulnerability to the disease, but also your risk of catching and passing it on to others. We now know with the Delta variant that your risk of catching the disease if you're vaccinated is roughly half what it would have been if you weren't. But once you catch it, you are just as much at risk as passing on to others than if you were not vaccinated. I believe that's the up-to-date information, but if you need to know, you probably need to look to an immunologist to pick it up. Now, in that context, the mandatory vaccination process makes us less safe than we thought it might. The key thing about vaccination is it keeps you safe from serious disease, and it keeps the system protected from being overwhelmed, because if people don't get as ill with COVID, then the pressures on our health system are much less great. The worry about mandatory vaccination of care home staff is that it may lead us being unable to look after the recipients of care in that system if the workforce chooses to leave rather than get vaccinated. And we're seeing some providers in England who are saying that is the impact of mandatory vaccination, but by no means all. I think I'd go back to the points we were making early on in this discussion about understanding the rationale for the hesitancy. So if people have not been vaccinated because it's difficult to access vaccinations, they can't take enough time off work because of their work patterns to get to the clinics, then the answer is to give them the opportunity to be vaccinated at work. If the issues are concerns about safety, then it makes sense to try and address those concerns head on. If the issues are more ideological, about the belief that irrespective of safety or otherwise, you have the right not to be vaccinated, then I think it's very reasonable for us as a society to say, well, you do have that right. What you don't have the right to do is to exercise it in a way that puts other people at risk. But you'd be saying to those people, you can work elsewhere. You don't have to work in the care system. But if you want to work in the care system, you have to take steps to protect the people you're looking after. So I think it's a strong case for requiring people to take care of the vulnerable people that they're responsible for. I'm doubtful whether or not passporting and mandatory vaccination really addresses the concerns, and I would be hopeful that we could address them more directly by looking at exactly why people are hesitant. But I think that's a matter of judgment, and it would be reasonable to see the judgment balancing on the other side. Thank you.
Judith?
It is clearly a very live issue. It's a very live issue in a context where care homes themselves are fundamental to supporting the whole health system, both deliver against COVID and everything else that is going on. And it's a live issue in the context of our withdrawal from the EU, where staffing issues within care homes are also difficult. To be honest, I would go back to first principles of really looking at the balance of people's rights within this process. I think Professor Montgomery's done an excellent job of really laying out some of the considerations in that. I would reiterate the points I made earlier about engaging with those individuals for whom the take-up rates are low within the care home setting and with providers. They also are very much part of that dynamic and with the people on the receiving end of care. So there's a lot of stakeholders in there whose views and whose rights are at stake in this discussion. And I think actually undertaking a sort of balanced analysis of all those rights and dialogue with those different stakeholders in different ways could lead to very, very different outcomes than going for a mandatory vaccine process. Basically for many of the reasons Professor Montgomery has outlined, but there may be very many more for actually engaging with all the stakeholders at stake in that discussion. So for me, that's the fundamental of a rights-based approach, is to undertake that analysis, undertake what's at stake, and then look at the evidence around that to see what supports what. Now, some of this decisions are already being made about this in different settings, and some of these, I suspect, will be tested in the courts. Because of this balance of rights and how sensitive it is, and so we will see some of that play out. The only thing I would say in the government, the Scottish government itself, doesn't have the power over employment rights, but it could potentially look at providing some kind of framework for decision making for employers in relation to this issue. Really unpacking the rights that potentially are at stake, providing the space to have pilot conversations in a human rights respecting way with the different stakeholders, and actually seeing what measures can be put in place to both increase take up, but also ensure that people's rights across those issues are respected and balanced. So there is a lot that could be done. That could happen before an ultimate decision is made to mandate vaccines, and so from my perspective, it is back to first principles in relation to obligations of government around people's balancing and testing of people's rights, and taking a rights-based approach within that.
Yourself, Rob, do you have any view on that?
Yeah, I think. We sort of welcome the fact that the vaccine passports would only be used in very specific settings, and they don't include key public services. And also note that sort of workers in the venues that will require a vaccine passport to be would be sort of exempt from the scheme. I think there's some issues when it sort of comes to employment, in that sort of vaccination itself is optional, but sort of complying with the law around sort of discrimination at work is sort of mandatory. If people are sort of sacked, or if employers are to sort of require people to be sort of double vaccinated as part of a conditioned employment, that gives rise to potential discrimination. If there's particularly if someone had a sort of long-term condition or were disabled, that's got the effect of sort of increasing the disability employment gap. I think at the sort of currently as far as I'm aware, that the latest version of the ACAS guidelines has sort of advised employers to support their staff to have the vaccine, but not to insist on it. And I think it's for those reasons is that that it may give rise to sort of potential discrimination claims. So on, for instance, sort of disability, sex, religion, belief, where there's areas there's potentially that there's really reasons related to a protective characteristic that people may not sort of take up the vaccine. So certainly we would be concerned around any sort of expansion of the scheme to cover sort of people's employment, and I think it would be sort of concerned about sort of employers requiring it.
Okay. The reason I asked that, and I'm going to go back to what Mr. Montgomery said at the start, the reason I asked that was proportionality as opposed to the rights of the individual, as opposed to the rights of the community, as it were. And the care home is kind of like a microcosm in my thinking about how we're doing this. So we accept the fact that we're giving people the choice. You can work in this care home, but you must do certain things in order to be protecting the people who are living here and working here and in this care home. And as Jonathan said, you can put that conditionality that they have to have the double vaccine. So we're also giving the choice in the process that we're going through at the moment in deciding whether we're going to have a COVID vaccine passport. As somebody who believes in independence, I don't necessarily agree that we should be, you know, taking our lessons from it. We should be free thinking ourselves. But there's COVID passport vaccines happening all across the world. But in terms of choice, people have the choice whether they go to a nightclub or whether they go to football. These are social events, so they have the choice of whether or not they want to do it. So is it proportionate, do you think, to say, for the greater good of society, you have the choice whether you want to go to a football match or go to a nightclub, and we know that these are areas where the spread happens. So therefore, if you choose to go there, you have a societal obligation to help us to try and mitigate the effects of this disease. Would you agree with that principle?
Happy to. Thank you. Sorry, my microphone didn't unmute me. So I think that's a very reasonable way to approach it. It depends on looking at the range of choices that are available to people and whether that range of choices is broadly consistent with the lives that they want to lead. So we at Ada Lovelace were really clear that you'd need a very strong justification for use passporting in elements of everyday life, such as shopping, going to work. If you identify a small group of events where people have alternatives that they can choose, it's very reasonable to expect them to take precautions when they go to those events to keep other members of the audiences safe. That doesn't undermine the point we began with, which is understanding why it is that it's thought that these categories are ones at a particular risk. And it doesn't undermine the concerns that vaccine passporting may actually have a counterproductive risk. It may make people think that they don't need to take other precautions. So I think I would be against thinking that answering that question is identical to answering the question about vaccine passporting, because yes, we should expect people to respect the rights and freedoms of others and take some responsibility for their own impact on that. But it's not clear to me that recognising that principle leads to precisely the proposal that we've been talking about, and understanding why it's thought that it does seems to be key. Thank you.
Can I just come back to you on that point? It doesn't mean to say that we're not saying that this is in isolation, the method or the methodology that we're going to try and suppress the vaccine. The messaging is still the same. We're still asking people to wear masks indoors. We're still asking people to take all the hygiene precautions. We're still doing everything else that we were currently doing. This is something that is being added on to a very targeted area where we want to see a greater uptake, and we want to make sure that we suppress the virus's ability. Now, you said yourself that we reduce it by about 50% if people get the vaccine. So it's another layer of our ability to suppress the vaccine. Would you accept that?
I think that depends on what the behavioural science tells us. So if we only have vaccinated people and their chance of passing it is reduced, of catching it is reduced by 50%, but then they stop wearing their face masks and they abandon social distancing and they're less cautious, the net effect might not be the one that we're after. So that's why it's important to understand the evidence. The general perception, as you know, when I talk to people about vaccine passports, is that they're seen as a message that if you've been vaccinated, it is safe for you to do these things. But I don't think that's the case with the Delta variant. It's still not entirely safe. It is safer. So I think that brings us back to the question, how much safer are these events if passported than not? So if the majority of people have been vaccinated who are going there, excluding the 10% or 15% who not, may not make a bigger impact on the overall safety of someone going in. That's what we need to know, and that's what we should monitor. And that's what I think a review process should be able to pick up. But I do think that argument is completely separate from the incentivization argument. And there, I think the question is, will people, if faced with this choice, take up the vaccine more? The French evidence suggests that they would do that. The French evidence suggests that introducing the vaccine passports for a much broader area of social life than Scotland is proposing did increase uptake, but they started from a much lower base than Scotland has. So whether it would have a proportionate impact in Scotland, I think is unclear. So I think those are all the questions, but it doesn't seem obvious to me without seeing the articulation of the evidence why that leads us to take this step at this stage. I'm not saying it doesn't, I'm saying that it isn't yet clear.
I'm sorry, Mr. Fairley, we've run out of time. We were doing well for time, and I'd like to just bring Alex Cole-Hamilton just briefly, please, because we're in the next
session. My questions are very brief. I'm grateful for you bringing back in, convener. Just yes or no questions, really, on this, just in interest of time. Professor Montgomery, you said in your opening remarks, you told us about a festival in Cornwall, I think it was called Corn Masters, at which required a vaccine passport for entry, but 5,000 people got sick. Was there also a requirement to bring a lateral flow, evidence of a negative lateral flow result for that festival as well?
Yes, I understand that it was both vaccine passports and testing.
Okay, that's very helpful to know. So whilst everyone knew that everyone was double jabbed and people were still presenting lateral flow tests, 5,000 people still got sick. It's not a foolproof device. Okay, moving quickly on then to Judith. Judith, you were very clear that state governments can only set aside their duty to act compatibly with things like the right to family life, right to privacy, right to freedom of thought, if, and I wrote it down, if it was necessary to address a pressing social need. Can you just tell us what happens if the government is not acting compatibly and is not presenting evidence that it is necessary to address that social need? Is there a sanction?
Good question. The immediate sanction, or there is no immediate sanction. The sanction would ultimately happen in the court, I suspect, if it was identified that somebody decided to take the government to court on the introduction of this scheme, and aspects of these areas were not established by the government, then that could be brought into bearing in a court discussion about the efficacy of the scheme, the human rights compliance of the scheme, and a decision would be made thereof. So there is no immediate sanction other than this conversation and other dialogue with government in relation to their obligations, except through a final court judgment where it would be deemed it was an infringement of the right to family life, the right to cultural life, and that decision would be made and would have to be upheld by the government.
So from everything you've told us today, you're not satisfied that you've seen sufficient evidence as yet from this government that this measure proves the necessity to drive down this very pressing social need. In fact, as we've heard of the example of the Cornmasters Festival, there's actually evidence to the contrary that it doesn't actually drive down this very, very pressing social need. What kind of evidence would you like to see to satisfy that requirement, to set aside those very important human rights?
We'd like to see the evidence that the government is basing its decision on. So if the government will have evidence, the government. We do trust the government that has made this decision on the basis of evidence, and so simply that is what we're looking for the evidence of. What is the basis of the evidence? So there may be evidence there that the government is using that isn't currently in the public domain, which absolutely justifies this decision to be made in this way. Professor Montgomery has outlined very many areas of that evidence, but we'd like to see that evidence.
And final question, if I may, Convener. This is obviously a very controversial issue. We see a legal challenge being mounted by the Nighttime Industries Association. Are you surprised then, Judith, that if the government is sitting on compelling empirical evidence to suggest that this is an effective means of driving down this very pressing social need, that it is still sitting on it, that it doesn't... I mean, if I was in government and I had that evidence, I would rush it to the fore. Are you surprised by that?
We're concerned that evidence hasn't been made available publicly, and we've expressed that concern as of yesterday to the Cabinet Secretary, because we believe that there is a commitment to take a rights-based approach. We very much see that evidence base needing to be shared publicly so that this can be fully interrogated, and also using it as a real test case almost in how we do consider people's rights. This is a controversial issue. There is proportionality attached to it already. It's not a blanket use of COVID certification. It's a very limited area of public of life that this is being applied to, just in response to the previous question. So there have been key considerations have been made along the way to make this scheme, to adapt the scheme, modify the scheme, to make it potentially more rights respecting. But there's almost certainly more that could be done, and that, for me, crucial engagement with people who are actually potentially directly affected by this, in all the multiple natures of that, it seems to be missing. If it isn't missing, again, we'd like to see what that resulted in, what those dialogues and conversations resulted in. So that meaningful participation in people in the development of this scheme. So there's some further work to do.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Apologies, we are running late of time now. So I'd like to thank all the witnesses for their evidence and giving us their time this morning. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerk will be happy to liaise with you about how to do that. I will now suspend to allow a changeover of witnesses, and members are advised that there is a very short comfort break before the next session. Thank you. Apologies for the delay in starting this session. We shall now move on to the evidence on the latest ministerial statement on COVID-19 and subordinate legislation. I welcome Michael Matheson, Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy and Transport, Professor Jason Leach, National Clinical Director, Angus MacLeod, Deputy Director of Community Surveillance Division, and Graham Fisher, Deputy Director of the Scottish Government Legal Directive. Thank you for your attendance this morning. Cabinet Secretary, would you like to make any remarks before we open up to questions?
Good morning, Convener, and to the committee. I'll briefly address the instruments being considered by the committee today in order. The Scottish International Travel Regulations had provided that following arrival into Scotland, day 2 and day 8 COVID-19 tests must be carried out by public providers, that is, by the NHS in Scotland. The number 17 amendment allows those tests also to be supplied by private sector test providers, provided they are on the UK government published list of test providers. To get onto the list, the providers must self-declare compliance with relevant regulations and Department of Health and Social Care guidance. All providers must work towards and complete full UK accreditation service accreditation. Those who fail to follow the necessary stages of accreditation, achieve the required turnaround times for test results, are not clear in their pricing, or who act unethically, are being removed from the list by the DHSC. This amendment provided also for a small but significant number of seasonal agricultural workers unable to isolate on a named farm due to insufficient accommodation. It allows them to isolate to the same standards as any other amber list arrival on off-farm accommodation organised by their employers. The number 18 amendment regulations relates to COP26. As I'm sure members are aware, COP26 will bring together countries to accelerate action towards the goals of the Paris Agreement and the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change in order to address climate change at an international level. COP26 and the World Leaders Summit are being held in person because of the complex nature of negotiations and the need for secure discussions. This requires exemptions to travel restrictions. The amendments provide for arrangements and exemptions from self-isolation, managed quarantine, day 2 and day 8 testing requirements, and for completion of the passenger locator forms for persons attending or facilitating COP26 and the COP26 World Leaders Summit, with the exemptions varying for different categories of attendees. More limited exemptions apply for those attending or facilitating COP26 who have not been invited to attend both COP26 and the World Leaders Summit by the UK government, or are not granted privileges and immunities in connection with COP26. Those who have been in a country or territory on the amber list in the 10 days before arrival in Scotland will not be required to self-isolate. Fully vaccinated persons who have been in a red list country or territory in the 10 days before arrival in Scotland will be required to undertake 5 days of managed quarantine rather than 10 days, and if not vaccinated, must quarantine for 10 days. For delegates who must stay in managed isolation, the definition of authorised vaccine is extended to include any vaccine authorised for use in the country in which it was administered. There is no exemption to the pre-arrival testing requirement to possess a negative result from a qualifying test. In order for the exemptions for COP26 and the World Leaders Summit to apply, individuals will be required to provide written confirmation that they will comply with the UNFCCC Code of Conduct, which sets out rigorous measures for the event. The code will mitigate the additional public health risks arising from holding in-person events in the UK and the exemptions to travel restrictions. The number 19 amendment to the regulations provides for an exemption from the requirement to enter managed self-isolation for participation in European professional football club fixtures in Scotland. They were made urgently due to players arriving into Glasgow from red list countries for a fixture taking place on Thursday, the 16th of September. This was due to a risk that home fixtures could be moved abroad to a neutral venue to allow European club players who played internationals in red list countries in the previous 10 days to participate. This would have caused significant disruption to Scottish clubs and home fans and generated a far higher risk of COVID transmission than a very small number of players travelling to Scotland. I hope, Convener, this is a helpful overview of the regulations that the committee are considering, and of course I'm happy to respond to any questions that the committee may have.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm conscious we only have 35 minutes for this session now, so I would ask that questions and answers please be restricted to about 4 to 5 minutes each. If I may begin by asking the first question. The recently updated travel advice from the Scottish Government, including the removal of the amber and green traffic light system, seems like great news for Scottish people hoping to be able to go abroad on holiday and return back to Scotland if they've been fully vaccinated. However, a remaining challenge, though, as I've been reminded by one of my constituents, is that Scottish people that are working abroad who are fully vaccinated, they're only able to return to Scotland for a holiday to see their families if they've been vaccinated in a limited amount of countries, such as the EU, US, and a very small handful of other countries. For those Scots who are living and working outside of the US and EU and are looking back to reconnect and see their families, even if they are fully vaccinated with the Pfizer or the AstraZeneca, they're not currently being considered vaccinated under the new guidelines. The issue seems to be one of where they are vaccinated, not with what vaccine. Can you tell me, are you aware of these challenges, and when do you anticipate that the qualifying countries will be expanded so fully vaccinated Scots can return home for a holiday without the 10-day quarantine?
There were some changes made last week which extend the number of countries which will qualify for the vaccination programme and for entry into Scotland and the UK as a whole. I am aware that there are some issues around vaccines being provided in other countries which are still restricted to the travel restrictions. However, I suspect Professor Jason Leach may be in a better place to give you a more detailed clinical understanding as to why that's the case and what action has been taken to try and address the issue.
Thank you. Can we bring in Professor Leach? Thank you.
Morning, everybody. Morning, Convener. There were 17 countries added to the vaccine list. That means the UK as a whole recognises vaccination given in those countries. It's two problems. One is type of vaccine. The other is certification of vaccine. Does that country provide a piece of paper, an app, an electronic version that allows it to be checked? For example, Zimbabwe gives no evidence of vaccination. It may well vaccinate its citizens, but the citizens have no evidence of vaccination. That's a challenge. So we added 17 new countries UK-wide, including a whole host of areas from around the world that are now recognised. That list will be kept under review. Ministers will get advice when new countries should be added.
Thank you. If I can move on to Meadow Fraser for your question, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and colleagues. I wanted to ask about the issue of PCR tests for international travellers. First of all, I very much welcome the instrument before us, which is opening up to private sector providers for those travelling, because I certainly had a number of constituents raising complaints with me about the cost of doing the PCR test through the one previously designated provider. So that's a very welcome change. However, there is an outstanding issue you'll be very aware of, which is that the UK government has announced their intention to remove the requirement for international travellers who have been double jabbed to have a PCR test in addition when travelling. And the First Minister indicated on Tuesday the Scottish government were considering what steps they would take in this respect. Now, the travel industry have been very vocal on this, as I'm sure you're aware. They are concerned there will be people looking to perhaps book last-minute travel for the October break, who, as Scottish residents, will now look to fly from an English airport because they will therefore avoid that requirement for PCR tests, and that will be to the detriment of the Scottish travel industry and Scottish airports. And every day that goes by potentially costs the Scottish travel industry because people are making those bookings right now. So can I ask you, Cabinet Secretary, when will we get a decision from the Scottish Government on this issue?
So two aspects to this. The first is in relation to pre-departure testing and the requirement for pre-departure testing and removing that requirement, which the UK Government set out that they intend to take forward. And the second is in relation to the day two testing, PCR testing, which is required. I think it's important to understand and recognise the importance of both of these tests. So the first, in terms of pre-departure testing, is to certify the person is not positive at that particular time when they are getting into an aircraft and potentially then infecting other people on the aircraft. So it plays an important element in terms of trying to reduce the risk of infecting other individuals, which I understand from a contact tracing point of view becomes very complex when infection takes place on an aircraft. The second is in relation to the PCR testing at day two. This plays an important element in our surveillance programme to identify potential variants of concern. And removing the requirement for a PCR test at day two potentially compromises that significantly. So our ability to identify variants of concern coming into the country should someone be infected and for that to be genome sequenced is significantly impacted if we remove that day two PCR test. And if you simply go to a lateral flow test, you don't have the same ability to undertake the genomic sequencing as you can with a PCR test. Given the decision by the UK Government, we've sought further advice, as the First Minister stated in our statement to Parliament on Tuesday, and officials are still providing that advice. And I would expect that the First Minister will be looking to set that out as early as possible and hopefully in the next day or two in response to the further advice we'll receive from clinicians. It should be, and I'll be quite open with the committee here, is that the clinical advice is that PCR testing for both pre-departure testing and day two should remain in place. It plays an important role. And you'll be aware, Mr. Fraser, that it's not just the Scottish Government that have raised significant concerns about this, but it's also other devolved nations that have raised significant concerns around the approach that the UK Government is taking on this issue. However, we also need to recognise the potential benefits that we will get from continuing with our existing regime, given the action that the UK Government is taking, because people will simply choose to go to airports in England, and also the impact that it also has on the aviation sector. So these are factors that we are taking into account alongside the clinical advice around the value of both pre-departure tests and day two PCR testing.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. Can I move to Jim Fairley?
Yes, thank you, Convener. You caught me out there. can I first of all go to the Cabinet Secretary and ask about the COP26, the factors that you're considering there? I know you briefly outlined them. Was there any lessons learned from the recent G7? Was there any problems after the G7 that you know about? Are some of the systems that you're going to put in place for the COP26 similar to what happened with the G7?
So you'll appreciate the G7 scale event is much, much smaller than it is for COP26. So the number of individuals is of a much smaller scale compared to COP26. Some of the aspects of what we have sought to put in place or agreed to put in place for COP26 is to try and reach a level where we can facilitate in-person COP to take place, because it's so important and we recognise the significance of this particular event. while trying to mitigate against some of the risks, which is why we have some of the testing regime and the restrictions in place. I wouldn't say we've drawn directly on the lessons from the G7 because of the nature and scale of it's very different, with COP26 being significantly larger. But I can assure you that we've tried to strike a balance here of trying to allow COP26 to take place in person while also trying to mitigate against some of the risks associated with such a large number of people coming together over a relatively limited period of time.
Okay, and my second question is it's more a constituency-based one. We still have constituents who are getting the first jag in England, second jag in Scotland, and the connection hasn't been made yet, and they're struggling to get their vaccine certificate. Can you possibly tell us, are we any closer to getting a solution to that?
So I think, Mr. Fairley, I'm probably best to hand you over here to Professor Jason Leach, because he's involved in trying to look at getting resolution specifically to this matter.
Thanks, Mr. Fairley and Cabinet Secretary. Yes, we do have a solution. There's just a backlog to fix them. So they should phone the helpline and the helpline will fix it, but it won't fix it instantly. It can be quite complex with identification numbers in both the countries, but we have solutions, but there's just quite a lot of them. So the helpline and those behind the helpline doing the tech solutions are working their way through them. So we've fixed a lot, but if there are some remaining, there's a form on NHS Inform and or the helpline, and they'll get to it as quick as they possibly can.
Excellent. My constituents will be delighted. Thank you.
Mr. Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and to the panel. I think if I could move on from my colleague, Mr. Fairley's questions around COP, I think one of the things we did learn from the European Championships is the balance that has to be struck and bringing together people from across different countries will increase significantly the infection rate. I think we recognise that. COP is obviously going to be even more of a significant risk given the number of countries that it involves. So there is a balance to be had between risk and benefit. And I wonder if Mr. Matheson will perhaps comment on that, on the evidence, and is it the government's intention to publish the evidence around that sort of safety against benefit risk?
So the way we've taken this forward, Mr. Whittle, is through negotiations with the UK government, Scottish government, and the UN to try and help to try and create a pathway for those attending as registered delegates to COP or the World Leaders Summit, able to facilitate in person negotiations and meetings. You'll be aware from the regulations that those who are travelling from high-risk countries, which would be classed as red-list countries, is that there are still much more stringent restrictions around them. So if they're unvaccinated, they will have to go into managed quarantine for 10 days in the same way that any other individual will, and will have to go through the normal testing regime as part of that in day two and at day eight. For those who are vaccinated, they will be able to reduce their managed quarantine period to 5 days if they're travelling from or have been in a red list country in the last 10 days. And at the same time, they will have to have PCR tests during the course of their quarantine. For those who are travelling from non-red list countries, there is still the requirement for pre-departure testing, passenger locator form, day two testing. There will also be a requirement for them to carry out daily lateral flow tests as part of the code of practice, which has been put in place by the UN to try and again minimise the risk. So we've tried to collaborate across the two governments and with the UN to try and find a mechanism that tries to manage the high-risk elements as best we can through managed quarantine and testing, while also trying to manage the broader risk through having pre-departure testing, day two testing, and daily lateral flow testing for delegates while they are attending COP, and also restricting these these arrangements to those who are registered delegates for COP26. So if you're not entitled to be a registered delegate, or you're not invited by the UK government to attend COP26, then these measures will not apply to you. So where we have relaxed them, it is only specifically for those who be registered delegates or invited participants in it. So we have sought to try and balance that. I think it's very difficult, though, Mr. Whittle, to say that I can easily give you I can give you information saying this is the balance of risks, other than trying to manage it in a planned way that helps to try and minimise the risks. And things like, we know, vaccine reduce risk, regular testing reduce risks, or early identification of positive cases. Managed quarantine helps to reduce risk. So we've put in place a whole range of measures, both to try to mitigate against the risk of people having the virus, while also reducing the risk of the potential importation of the virus as well.
If I just a quick follow-up to that, I think a key element of COP will be the fringe events that delegates will potentially interact with those who are not delegates and therefore haven't gone through that stringent testing. So what consideration is the government given there in terms of putting some safety protocols in place?
So keep in mind is that even fringe events that are taking place and the overlay of testing arrangements were put in place for COP delegates specifically, the overlay of restrictions that operate here in Scotland continue to apply to any fringe events. So ensuring that there is appropriate social distancing, that people are wearing masks, that there is also using good hand hygiene, etc. All of those measures will continue to apply in any venue, and also the numbers in venues will be limited on the basis of needing to maintain social distancing. So it's important to recognise that the layer of restrictions that we have in place at the present moment in Scotland will apply to fringe events for COP26, which means that venues that would normally be able to hold larger numbers of people will not be able to do so because of the need in order to make sure they manage numbers in a way that helps to support social distancing and mask wearing, etc.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can I ask Alex Rowley? You don't have any questions?
No.
John Mason? No questions. No questions? Okay, great. We can move on to agenda item number 6. I move on to the 6th agenda item, which is consideration of the motions on the made affirmative instruments considered during the previous agenda item. Cabinet Secretary, would you like to make any further remarks on the SSIs before we take the motions?
No further comment, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Are members content for the motions on the agenda to be moved en bloc? Yes. Thank you. The members are agreed to move the motions en bloc. I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to move en bloc motions S6M-01079, S6M-01186 and S6M-01261. Can I ask
move
Cabinet...
en bloc.
Thank you. Can I ask if any members would like to make any comments? No. I know no members have indicated that they wish to speak, so I'll now put the question on the motions. The question is that motions S6M-01079, S6M-01186 and S6M-01261 be agreed. Do members agree?
Yes.
Thank you. The motions are agreed. The committee will publish a report to the Parliament setting out our decision on the statutory instruments considered at this meeting in due course. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item and our time with the Cabinet Secretary. I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary and the supporting officials for their attendance this morning. The committee's next meeting will be on the 30th of September, when we will continue to take evidence on vaccination certification and will take evidence from the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID recovery on the ministerial statement of COVID-19 and the subordinate legislation. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning, and I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave.